It's my real pleasure to introduce Ellen Thomas, who will be speaking with us. She's joining us from her home in Connecticut, which you can see is done in a classical Romanesque style. Ellen, I guess I first met and became aware of when I was a graduate student working on the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum. And one of the things that happened during that global warming event is, all these little protist predators hanging around at the bottom of the ocean went extinct. And people had, all kinds of ideas and would always, you know, talk about what they think happened and why these things suffered. So, but then I learned that there was this amazing researcher, Ellen, who actually knew and cared about these things and understood their physiology and ecology and could actually say something authoritative about what could and couldn't have happened to the benthic foraminifera during the event. So, gosh, I learned a little bit about her thoughts about that, and then learned about all the other kinds of cool research that she's been involved with over the years. She's a paleoceanographer and specializes in benthic forams, but has more generally been involved in the paleoceanographic community, advocate for ocean drilling, and involved in all kinds of research focusing on extinction events and warm climates of the late Mesozoic and Cenozoic. She got her training at the University of Utrecht in the Netherlands. I think all your degrees from there, if I remember right.
That's right.
And is now a faculty member and researcher at, with affiliations at Wesleyan and at Yale University. She is a kind of highly awarded researcher. She's got, she's a fellow of AGU, GSA, and AAAS. She's this year going to receive the Cushman Award, Cushman Society for Foraminiferal Research. She's got the Brady Medal from the Micropaleontological Society and AGU's Maurice Ewing Medal. And in addition to all her great research that we'll hear more about, she's also done all kinds of really stellar service for the geoscience and paleoceanography communities. And among that, the roles she's played, she's been editor-in-chief for geology, which must be one hell of a job, as well as paleoceanography, and now paleoceanography and paleoclimatology, a journal which I've had the pleasure of working with her on over the last several years, in which she's helped kind of transition from a very oceanography-focused format, something that's now much broader and more inclusive as a paleo journal. I think that's gone really well, largely thanks to Ellen's efforts. So I will stop talking now and let Ellen, I guess, share her slides and tell us what she's going to tell us about carbon cycle and warm worlds.
Okay, let me get this going here. Hit this thing here. All right. So this coming through?
Looks good.
All right. So I'll be talking about the oceanic carbon cycle in the greenhouse world. And I'll be talking about oceanic export and primary productivity. As Gabe said, I really am someone who likes benthic forams, and you can see that since I have a whole bunch of pictures here at the bottom. And so, actually, whatever I title a talk, it will turn out that I'll be talking about benthic forams anyway. Only if I say that I'll be talking about benthic forams, then no one is going to show up. So I have to sell it some other way. All right, so let me see. All right. Because I really like benthic forams, I am really quite passionate about trying to understand the deep sea environment, and particularly deep sea processes and ecosystems. And the deep sea is the largest habitat on Earth. We always have to make things important that we work on, right? So although this is the largest habitat on Earth, it is really an alien world. We know very little of the deep oceans in the present world, and you know, let alone knowing about the past. And as Discover magazine said, for a human, the deep sea is as alien as deep space. And many of the things that live there indeed look kind of like aliens. I myself am interested in those deep sea benthic forams. And because I'm so interested in them, I'm also involved in CT scanning them. And over here on the left-hand side, you see one of my printed out 3D plastic models of this object over here. You see a light microscope figure. And so I'm also proselytizing everyone into liking deep sea benthic forams. All right, so that means that I take this step from life in a single cell to global change. And that single cell is then a foram. And so again, this is one of the most chemically analyzed and dissolved benthic forams around. You will see that later. And so you can start to talk at single celled organisms, and you can end up talking about the whole world, specifically because the deep sea is this largest habitat on Earth. And if things happen to change what is going on with organisms in the deep ocean, then you must be talking about something that is important globally. So what kind of single cell are we talking about? We're talking about foraminifera, which are unicellular and eukaryotes, so complex celled kind of organisms. They also make this complex multi-chambered cell. And so you can see here all those chambers in a spiral. This is still a one-celled organism. And when they're alive, there is protoplasm inside as well as on the outside. There is a main opening, the aperture. It is this little edgy thing that my pointer is pointing at the moment. And they stream out pseudopods. And so you can just use their morphology to reconstruct their populations over time, classical paleontology. So you could ask, what use is the shell of foraminifera? And so for foraminifera, we do not quite know what the use of the shell is actually. I think Gabe was exaggerating a bit about how well I understand foraminifera. And we still have a debate why they form a shell. And because they are small things that live in a high density world, so they don't need any support. And on the other hand, it doesn't really protect them against being eaten, because most predators on benthic forams are detritus eaters. And so they just gobble up the sediment form and all, whether they have a shell or not. However, for us humans, the use is that we can use this shell to reconstruct the environment in which foraminifera calcified. And as an example of what we can do with this combination of looking at morphology of organisms and information on the environment in which they calcify, I will be talking about those global warming episodes, also called hyperthermals, in this time period about 56 to 50 million years ago. The ones I'm talking about will be all in the Eocene, so those are called Eocene thermal maxima. Oh, I forgot to say, if anyone wants to ask a question, just interrupt me. That's what I have in person, and I don't mind at all if you interrupt me while I don't see you and you're far away on the screen somewhere. All right, so for those of you who haven't thought about this, we analyze those calcium carbonate shells for various trace element and stable isotope properties. And so we have both planktic, this upper model here, and benthic forams. So by analyzing the shells, we can get information on all those complex processes that are happening within the oceans, from the surface, for which we look at planktics, to the bottom, where we look at benthics. And so carbon and oxygen isotopes, I will mention numerous times later on. Those are pretty much the workhorses of paleoceanography. Magnesium, calcium can tell us something about temperatures. Iodine calcium is a relatively new proxy, which I'm working on with Zunli Liu at Syracuse University, that can tell us something about oxygenation. And then boron calcium and boron isotopes can tell us something about the pH during the precipitation in the waters during the precipitation of the shell. And I've been working on that with Mike Hanahan. In this talk, I will be talking about biogenic barite, so that is not a property of the shell of forams. And I've been working on that with Liz Griffith now at Ohio State University and Adina Payton now at Santa Cruz. And so we can learn from those shell compositions about the environment. And we can learn about, from the foraminifera, about the reaction of organisms on what is going on in the world. All right, so I'm going back to my bentic forearms, and I always like to use this cartoon by Gerhard Smiedel, the University of Hamburg, because he can make much cuter pictures of foraminifera than I can. And so we see here, there's no vertical scale. This is the deep sea, so this is actually a couple of kilometers of water. And what is typical for the deep sea is that not only it's always cold and always dark, it's also, and probably more important, extremely poor in food supply. And that is because the biota on the deep sea floor depends on food that comes from the surface where we have light and photosynthesis. And so you see some diatoms over here, phytoplankton, calcareous nanoplankton, and planktic forams. And all those guys live in the sunlit surface waters. And those sunlit surface waters are overlying this really large and deep black abyss. And my benthic forams live at the bottom of the abyss. And they live in different places, above and within the sediment. And thus their shells give me information on conditions in the bottom waters, if I talk about things on top of the sediment, and at different depths in the pore waters, as I look, if I look at forams that live inside the sediment. So what we have, and this goes not just for forams, but for all deep sea dwelling organisms, is that we, in essence, have a coupling between the surface where we make the food and the organisms that live on the bottom. And the nature of this coupling was actually only realized in detail since the JGOS program started, Joint Global Ocean Flux Study started somewhere in the 1980s, when we started to get more information on how this coupling worked. And this strange picture here on the right shows some fluffy phytodetrital material, which is produced in the surface waters. This is a mixture of various shells of phytoplankton, shells of zooplankton, bits and pieces of the body parts of all kinds of planktonic things, rests of organic matter. And once we have blooms, for instance, in the spring at mid-latitudes in the surface waters, then in a couple of weeks, this phytodetrital material, this fluffy stuff, is transported to the deep sea floor, so that we have a clear link between the surface dwellers and the bottom dwellers. It is because of this link, this bentopelagic coupling, that benthic foraminifera accumulation rates, as well as the species composition of the assemblage, can be used as some kind of anywhere between qualitative, semi-quantitative, and some people have argued even quantitative proxies for what goes on in the surface water, and that is what goes on with the productivity in the surface waters. And so to talk some more about benthic forams, which I can do for a long time, keep quiet, I'll talk about other things afterwards. You're not going to be bored with those the whole time. If you go back to a couple of papers by Frans Joris and Alf going back to the 90s, and this picture here is a later version of it from Caroline Coho. And so what we're looking at in those deep sea benthic faunas, where the food supply is the limiting parameter in many cases, is that what species there are and how they abundant there are depend on this food supply, both its amount and its variability, for instance, yearly, or if you're in the tropics, for instance, you can think about such events as Enzo, yeah, you have a couple of year variability in productivity and food supply. And if you simplify this, then we can go from a low food supply oligotrophic conditions at the left of this plot to eutrophic conditions at the right of this plot. And what we see is this balance that we have food going from very low to very high, but this goes with oxygen going from very low at a high food supply, because of course this organic matter is going to be oxidized and it will use up oxygen in oxidation. And so all those different little blobs are different species of foraminifera. And what we get is in the oxic zone, in essence, many organisms could live within the sediment because it's oxygenated. Many eukaryotic organisms could live there, but they don't because there is just so little food. And the food that arrives on the seafloor is in essence just used up by the organism sitting on top of the seafloor. If we go to increase in food, then what we're starting to see is more diverse populations of forams that live in part on top of the sediment, in part below the sediment. And in the sediment, because of the oxidation of organic matter, we're starting to see those different zones, and that we also see, of course, in the chemistry of pore waters, in which we have oxygenated zones at the top, lower oxygen, dixoxic, and even anoxic conditions at greater depths. And you can see that carefully, there is no depth here in centimeters. This is just a general image. If you go to the highest food conditions, then in some places, our organic matter supply is so high that it just uses up all the available oxygen in the pore waters. And of course, if you're in coastal waters, as we see because of human-induced pollution, we can see that actually the anoxic conditions extend into the water column. So again, if you look at this little display of benthic forams, we can see that the benthic foram species composition, if we can recognize those various species, can tell us something about productivity. And this was used from the early 90s on by Wolf Berger at Smith with Juan Herguera. They had this seminal paper in which they start to quantify benthic foramoliferal accumulation rates, which they linked to the arrival of organic matter to the seafloor. And they actually had this kind of cute statement in which they linked benthic forams larger than 150 micron to the amount of organic carbon that arrived at the seafloor. And what they were arguing from a number of core top in the Pacific Ocean was that if you have one benthic foram larger than 150 micron in diameter, then you have about a milligram of organic carbon per square centimeter per 1,000 years. It's not like they need a lot of organic matter, but still, even that amount of organic matter is actually not arriving to the deep seafloor in many localities. And so what we see is then that if you figure out how much organic carbon arrives at the seafloor, and this is actually what most of my talk will be about, then you have to somehow link that to primary productivity in the surface waters. And that is linked through this formula by Herguera and Berger, in which PP is the primary productivity and Z is the depth. And of course, you have much less organic matter making it to the seafloor if the water is getting deeper. And an often used exponential equation is this by Martin et al., derived for the North Pacific from sediment traps, in which you see that the moles of carbon per square year produced at the surface decline if you get at greater depths. There, of course, the organic matter is used by organisms living in the water column, and it's not replenished because there is no light for photosynthesis. And so benthic foraminiferal accumulation rates were linked to primary productivity in some non-linear fashion. All right. Obviously, not everyone likes benthic forams, and there is, in fact, a lot of geochemists in the world who have their own proxies for primary productivity. And so a very important proxy for primary productivity is what has been called the biogenic barium accumulation rates. And I'm referring here to a paper by Adina Payton and Liz Griffith, who kind of make a compilation of lots of earlier work on this and give a good review on the status of this proxy. But this proxy go back in time for many different workers, including Miriam Kästner at Scripps. So if you look at this plot over here, with ocean depths again and some kind of logarithmic function, the photic zone 0 to 100 meter up here, the mesopelagic zone between 100 and 1,000 meters, and then the deep part, the batopelagic zone. And so my benthic forams live here on the deep seafloor. We see photosynthesis and the formation of all this particulate organic matter and grazing and respiration. And so particulate organic matter is made in those surface waters where we have light. Part of that is then oxidized and we have dissolved organic carbon as well as dissolved inorganic carbon forming from this particulate organic carbon. Some of this material is then exported down outside this photic zone. You see the export flux indicated here into the so-called twilight zone, in which we find more scavenging and solubilization and formation of more dissolved organic carbon. And the particular organic carbon over here is then being reused by many organisms. What we see is that barium is released from organic matter in this mesopelagic zone. The barium is enriched in phytoplankton, and it comes out of this organic matter in the mesopelagic zones, so that barium concentrations increase. In general, barium sulfate is undersaturated in the world's ocean, but barium concentrations increase, and we see barium barite precipitation in microenvironments within those particles of decaying organic matter. And so that means that the barite crystals formed in this marine realm, in this twilight zone, are then deposited to the seafloor, and they are some kind of proxy for export productivity. And this is a picture from a paper with Liz Griffith that I'm working on at the moment. And so if you're looking over here, how much of this organic matter you are remineralizing determines to some extent how much of those particles you have where we can precipitate barite. And so barite is an indicator for the amount of organic carbon that is remineralized in this twilight zone. All right, so we have several proxies for primary productivity, one of which is this benthic forum accumulation rate, and another one of which is this biogenic barium accumulation rates. And here I show some of the earlier people who have worked on biogenic barium. And so in general, the higher benthic forum accumulation rates tell you that more food made it to the seafloor, so that you could support more benthic forams living on that seafloor on and in the sea. Biogenic barium tells you something about the export from the photic zone into this mesopelagic zone in microenvironments in this decomposing organic matter. And so higher biogenic barium accumulation rates means that there is more organic carbon that was transported out of the euphotic zone and remineralized, regenerated in that zone. So in fact, those are both proxies used to estimate the same thing, primary productivity, because everything else being equal, both the benthic forum accumulation rate and this rate of accumulation of biogenic barium is linked to primary productivity in the surface waters. And so they reflect, however, different parts of this process of transfer of organic matter from the surface to the deep seafloor. And so we can extrapolate back to primary productivity only if we have a function, this exponential type function, in which we can link primary productivity to what goes on at the seafloor. And we can only do that if this specific function does not change over the time period that we're studying. All right. However, it is so that only an extremely small part of this primarily produced organic matter reaches the seafloor at depths below this twilight zone of about 1,000 meters. And I'm showing this with a picture of sediment trap particulate organic carbon flux, as well as remotely sensed estimates in this publication by Lutz et al. In which the top, we look at export productivity out of the photic zone, and then we're starting to see reconstructions from data in sediment traps about how much flux is left over at 1 or 2.5 kilometers, or at the seafloor in places where that is more than 2.5 kilometers. And this color scale is a logarithmic scale. And so already you can see, even without getting into the numbers, that only a really puny amount of material actually makes it to the deep sea floor. And so to rub that in a bit more, and I always like to use some of the artwork from Glyn Gorick, who has done a lot of artwork for major scientific programs of ocean going science. And what you see here is just a small bit of ocean water with all those different microorganisms, unicellular organisms, small animals, which are all floating around in those surface waters and all chemically affecting the composition of the seawater here. And some of those places with decaying organic matter, like this exploding diatom, which is taken apart by a virus, are the places of the organic matter where we form this biogenic barium. And how much of this makes it to the seafloor? And so that depends on how we form those particles, how large they become, because that determines if they're actually going to be sinking at all in the ocean, yes or no. So we aggregate more of them if they get stickier. And they aggregate more if we have more production of this sticky material, the glue, those transparent exopolymer particles and gels given by this strange kind of blobby thing. Then fecal pellet formation makes fecal pellets that are larger than those unicellular producers. And those fecal pellets fall to the seafloor. And it used to be thought that making fecal pellets always increases the deposition of organic matter to the seafloor, but it now turns out to be more complex because that zooplankton actually breaks up those big aggregates of organic matter, the marine snow, and that makes them fall back to smaller particles that then are transported to the seafloor slower. And so the fecal pellet formation and aggregation compete and interact as to their effect on deposition of organic matter to the seafloor. Then there's the still debated effect of ballasting. If we add in more phytoplankton with shells, such as diatoms, can we downweigh this organic matter by the skeletons? And there's a lot of discussion about that. At the moment, I think more people think that biogenic calcium carbonate, the planktonic forams and calcareous nanoplankton, doing a better job of weighing down things than biogenic silica. There's also still the possibility that just such factors as wind, bone, dust affects how fast those things are deposited to the seafloor. However, what is an important factor, and that's why I put it in red here, is just that the ecosystem structure has a great important factor in the formation of those particles, how large they are, and how fast they are deposited to the seafloor. And of course, since this ecosystem structure is important, that means that we cannot assume that those functions, exponential functions, of how much organic matter makes it to the seafloor is actually anywhere like consistent or permanent over times of changes in climate, for instance. So this was my story on the present day environment and on the transport to the deep sea. And as we have started to realize with more recent than 1987 observations in many parts of the world sea, there are, because this process is ecosystem dependent, very large geographic differences in the transfer of organic matter to the deep sea, which are driven by those ecosystem differences. And so wherever we go in the world, we get very different transfer of this organic matter to the deep sea. And to emphasize once again, only a very small fraction of this net primary productivity reaches the seafloor. And so once again, we see a plot here of particulate organic matter, dissolved organic matter, the formation of this barite within this twilight zone between 100 and 1,000 meter, and then our benthic forams at the seafloor. So if you think about this, that only such a very, very small fraction of net primary productivity reaches the deep seafloor, then you could kind of more or less intuitively think that actually changes in this formation of net primary productivity and the transfer to this of this small fraction to the seafloor could be important, more important for the benthic forams and everything else living on the deep seafloor than changes in primary productivity. To me, at least, it seems that it is easier to change this process running from productivity as proxied by nanoplankton here to export productivity as proxied by biogenic barium to what arrives at the seafloor as proxied by benthic forams. I think it is easier to do and will happen more often in the ocean that this changes by a factor of about 2, so that the amount of organic matter that reaches benthic forams doubles, than it is to actually double the primary productivity in the surface waters. That is a huge difference, and that is not easy. And you have to bring normal nutrients to the phytoplankton in the deep ocean. And so I had never thought about this before I started to work on proxies for productivity. But then I, after actually doing that and saying, oh, I'm looking at benthic forum, so I'm looking at productivity, I start to realize that I may not look at productivity as much as that I'm looking at changes in this process of transferring organic matter from the surface to the deep ocean. Now to the past. Because, of course, once we go to the past, the ecosystems are very different from today. And I'm just using a very simplified plot to kind of emphasize this in a paper by Dick Norris et al., which they published in Science a couple of years ago, already 7 years ago by now, in which if you look at the present day world, then we have particularly at high latitudes, productivity by large phytoplankton. Those are still single-celled things, but there are such things as eukaryote diatoms, several hundreds of micrometers. Whereas if we go to warmer areas in which we have less upwelling, we find more productivity by bacterial plankton. For instance, cyanobacteria, which can, for instance, fix nitrogen from the atmosphere rather than being dependent on influx of nitrogen, nutrient nitrogen from land or upwelling in the open ocean. And so this whole world would look different as to productivity of organic matter, but also as to how we transport this organic matter to the deep sea floor and how much of this organic matter is remineralized before it reaches the deep sea floor. And how much of this organic matter is remineralized also then will be important for determining how large the oxygen minimum zones in the ocean are. Because in remineralization, organic matter is oxidized, which uses up oxygen from the water column. All right, I'll finally get to the time period which I'll be talking about. And I'm using this background figure in which I'm showing benthic oxygen isotopes and benthic carbon isotopes. And this paper was just a week ago or so published by Tom Westerholt and many others in Science. And this is basically climate over the Cenozoic. So we start at the left at the beginning of the Cenozoic, at the end of the Cretaceous, this line between green and brown is over here. And what we're seeing is this line that tells us something about the mean temperature difference from today, with getting warmer going up and getting colder going down. This is today. And so if you look at this, then we can see this kind of blue region with a red line through it. And you see the small crosses over here in the background. And I show a picture here of my benthic forams. And so each of those little crosses then represent the analysis of several benthic forams. And it's kind of sad, so someone who likes benthic forams, if you just see it, how many little crosses there are, just imagine how many benthic forams have been dissolved in phosphoric acid in order to generate this curve. It's pretty sad if you like benthic forams. And there are tens of thousands of data points in here. And so those are hundreds of thousands of benthic forams who have been largely picked out by hardworking graduate students and then dissolved and analyzed. What we're looking at the lower curve are carbon isotopes. And those are analyzed then in the same benthic foraminifera because in dissolving a group of benthic forams, we get both oxygen and carbon isotopic data. What we're seeing then is this period of great warmth, the early Eocene climate optimum. And however, we also see shorter peaks in warming. And one of them is this extensive one. And Gabe Bowen already mentioned this period, the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum, also called Eocene thermal maximum 1. And those are what we call hyperthermal events. And they can happen at other times in the Paleocene, for instance, but I'll be talking about the ones in the Eocene. And what is typical for those hyperthermals is that we have an episode of warming, which is proxied here in the oxygen isotopes, several degrees of warming. At the same time is that we have a big excursion towards isotopic light values in carbon isotopes. So we have a negative carbon isotopic excursion at the same time as that we see warming. We get a negative carbon isotopic excursion as a result of what we are doing, fossil fuel burning, as a result of rapid transfer of isotopically light CO2 from the lithosphere, where it cannot affect climate, into the atmosphere, where it obviously is affecting climate. And so we're looking at here geological counterparts, although slower, from fossil fuel burning. And I'm not going to talk about where we got this isotopically light CO2, because this is one of the things that lots of us are still happily fighting about. We don't really know what caused this. There's been various options, some combination of volcanic CO2, which is not isotopically light enough to actually cause those big spikes, with organic carbon, for instance, by volcanic intrusions, heating up and baking organic carbon, which was happening in the North Atlantic. Another possible source is the release of methane from ice, from methane hydrates, which occur under low temperatures and high pressures in the deep sea, and which can dissociate if we warm up the deep sea. As we all know from thinking about the present and future, if we release the CO2 into the atmosphere, then not only do we warm up the world, some of the CO2, of course, is present in the ocean water, and it will cause ocean acidification and carbonate dissolution. So what we're seeing in those records is an overall warm period in which we see superimposed a number of hyperthermal events, called Eocene thermal maxima and Eocene. And I will be talking about three of those, a PTM or Eocene thermal maximum 1, ETM2 or Eocene thermal maximum 2, which in the literature has also been called the ELMO event. And there is ETM3, which also has been called the X event. And you can kind of see them here if you glint in those two little spikes in carbon isotopes. So that's the time period I will be talking about. And if I just look at them in course, since I was showing you carbon oxygen isotopes, which showed warming as well as evidence for this release of isotopically light carbon, I didn't show you the carbonate dissolution. I'm showing you here the core photographs from three cores at the site in Walvis Ridge in the Southeast Atlantic, site 1262. The light colors show calcium carbonate, the dark colors intervals of dissolution, and you have to kind of put all those sections on top of each other. This is the highest section, and then you go deeper in the hole. And here we have the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum. All right, so the Paleocene-Eocene thermal maximum is important for me because it is the only deep sea benthic forum extinction in the last about 90 million years. And I'm not saying that because I know of bigger ones earlier than that. I'm saying that because benthic assemblages before 90 million years ago looked very, very different. We had a period of radiation and formation of new species just before 90 million years ago. And over that whole time period, we never, not at the end of the Cretaceous with great big impacting asteroids, saw a deep sea benthic forum extinction of about 30 to 50% of species, some of which you see figured over here. And so at this site, we see this clear evidence of ocean acidification, warming. We have at this site a particularly extensive warming of about 10 degrees centigrade as given by oxygen isotopes. In blue, we see the carbon isotopic excursion of almost 4 per mil here. And in red, we see the number of species of benthic forams, which declines to about 15 or so. What we then also see is that surviving benthic species, such as this one over here, and those pictures have the same magnification, get very, very small, although they are still well calcified during this event. And then they recover and get bigger. All right, the causes of this I also don't know. After all those years, despite Gabe saying that I know and understand so much of benthic forams, I still don't know what it is. I show you here four of them for possible causes, and over time I've written papers in which I emphasized each of the four of them, and so at the moment I'm weaseling and saying maybe it's some kind of combination of warming. Their metabolic rates go up if it gets warmer, so that makes them short in food. Changes in productivity, loss of oxygen. That's kind of difficult because animals such as ostracots are more sensitive to loss in oxygen and show less extinction. Or maybe ocean acidification, which makes it harder to form their shell. And ostracots animals are indeed also forming carbonate shells, but because they're animals, they have better control over their calcification than forams do. Microfossil data on calcareous nanofossils show in general that oceanic productivity was decreasing during the PETM in open ocean sites, such as Site 12 and 9 in the Pacific. At various marginal sites in shallow water, you saw an increased productivity. And similar data are shown for the later events, ETM2 and ETM3. And we envisage that in open ocean, we have increased stratification, a decline in upwelling, and declined food. Whereas in coastal zones, we have more runoff due to an increased hydrological cycle during a warm period, as we kind of see today, which brought more nutrients to those waters, and we had locally higher productivity. We modeled this with Arne Wingood as first author. And of course, the climate model doesn't work in coastal areas where we have, with this red dots, higher productivity. However, if you look in open ocean, then the modeling as well as our data, data shown by those circles, indicate indeed declined productivity in open ocean during this warm period. However, if this decreased productivity is true, then that happened, as shown in another paper, in which I also was a co-author, that actually this happened at increased export productivity, which is kind of counterintuitive, doesn't seem to make sense. Because if we try to reconstruct the PETM export productivity before the PETM and during the PETM, based on marine barium accumulation rates, then we seem to see increased export productivity. And so somewhere this doesn't make sense. And so if you look at the components of the carbon flux to the deep ocean, we have as components the primary productivity, the particle export product, and so the primary production can be proxied by calcareous nanofossils, phytoplankton in the surface waters. The particle export efficiency can be proxied by barite, which reflects what was going on in this twilight zone between 100 and 1,000 meters. Then there is the transfer efficiency from this material that is exported from the photic zone to the bottom of the ocean. And however much arrives at the seafloor and is used by benthic forams is actually proxied by benthic forams. So what Liz Griffith and I and various other people tried to do was compare the benthic foram accumulation rates with the biogenic barium accumulation rates over those three hyperthermal events, the PETM, Eocene thermal maxima 2 and 3. And since you use accumulation rates in both, you have no problems with the accuracy of the accumulation rates estimates. For some sites, I don't have the data on the accumulation rates, so I have to use the benthic foram faunal association. And so I already showed you this. This is this the data on the carbon isotopes, and I'm looking at the PETM, which is a very large event, and two of those much smaller events, ETM2, ETM3. And we're looking at the site in the Southeast Atlantic on Walvis Ridge, which is the shallower site on the ridge. All right, I'm showing you some data from this site. On the right-hand side, I show oxygen isotopes and carbon isotopes. And in blue are the data for the PETM. In red are the data for Eocene thermal maximum 2. And in green for Eocene thermal maximum 3. And those are all plotted by lining up the first beginning of the carbon isotopic excursion. And so you see the warming over here in delta 018 of benthic forams. You see the carbon isotope excursion. And in all of those, you see how much larger and massive the PETM was than those later events. If you look at the benthic diversity on the left-hand side, this is rarefaction, so I normalize for the number of specimens studied. And again, you see this huge drop in diversity at the PETM in blue. then you do see drops in diversity, although there is no extinction in red for Eocene thermal maximum 2 and in green for Eocene thermal maximum 3. And here I'm just looking at indicators for low food supply as well as calcium carbonate corrosivity in the benthic forams. Okay, so those are the data. Those are actually the only data that I wanted to talk about today. So look at this plot for a bit. What I'm comparing here is in blue, the barite accumulation rates, and in green, data on benthic forum accumulation rates or on the oligotrophic taxa abundance. And in gray and in black, you see the oxygen and carbon isotopes. And so what you're seeing here is that after this introductory period, the onset of the carbon isotopic excursion, where we're starting to have enough specimens for benthic forums to say something about, is that we're seeing, in fact, opposite trends in the barite and in the benthic forams. The barite accumulation rates, as in that original paper that I was citing of Mayadal, increases during the PTM, whereas at the same time, the benthic forum accumulation rate or the species composition declines. And we see that at all the three sites. So at this site, across the PTM and ETM 2 and 3, we see an increase in barium accumulation rate, which suggests increased export productivity, combined with benthic foraminifer evidence for decreased arrival of organic matter at the seafloor. So more organic matter went out of the photic zone, but less of that arrived at the deep seafloor. So what happened? So that means it didn't make it to the deep sea floor. And that can be explained, for me that seems the simplest way of explaining it, by increased remineralization at this interval in between, in this mesopelagic zone. That time would have also led to expanding oxygen minimum zones, which are observed to happen during those periods, as well as an increased pool of dissolved organic matter in the oceans. Why would that happen? Well, the first thing I'm thinking of is that you had increased metabolic rates of organisms in the oceans, including forams. And we see in the present day ocean that this increase in metabolic rates is larger in heterotrophs than in autotrophs that produce the organic matter, because the heterotrophs are just seeing the temperature effects, whereas the autotrophs cannot just increase their metabolic rates without getting more food supplied. And so, because our two proxies that could indicate changes in productivity are contradicting each other, we can't really say whether the net productivity increased, decreased, or remained the same, although data on calcareous nanoplankton, shown here at the lower side, calcareous nanoplankton, to remind me of that, show that productivity stayed either the same or decreased or increased maybe a little bit, but hardly significantly. So you could argue maybe you're not looking at changes of mineralization, remineralization. You could argue that we're looking at release of barium through gas hydrate dissociation. If it is true that this whole event was caused by release of isotopically light carbon from gas hydrates, then gas hydrates in the present day oceans are enriched in barium. And so if we dissociate gas hydrates, then we could bring more barium in the ocean. And that means we could see more barium, not because of increased remineralization, but because we had more dissolved barium in the oceans, which increased the barium sulfate saturation state and thus increased the preservation of barite without changes in export production. And I myself was actually a co-author with Jerry Dickens on this paper arguing for this. But you know, over time, you can change your mind. And so now I don't think that this is a major factor, because we also measured strontium barium in marine barite, and the strontium barium ratios indicate that there was no increase in barite saturation state in the oceans. There's now also barium isotope data which agree with our data that I was just showing you, that there's actually a time lag with between the increase in barium, and the time lag is longer than the barium residence time, with the initiation of the carbon isotope excursion. And so we must have started this change in the carbon isotope excursion and the dissociation of gas hydrate if that happened before we had a change in the barium. Also, Liz Griffith, my co-author on those, has been working on with Sam Carter on a change in the parameterization of this modeling of export production and particulate barium flux. And that has changed the model that Jerry Dickens and I and several others used in 2003, arguing that it is not necessary to increase the deep water barium saturation and hence preservation at this time. Okay, that was only one side. How typical is this for the whole ocean? And we'd like to, of course, argue that this happens all over the ocean, and it is more important that things happen in the Pacific Ocean, which was a larger ocean than anywhere else. During the PETM itself, site 1209, where we have only very few data points, actually, because the sedimentation rates are low in this peak event, we do seem the same. We have a drop in the productivity from benthic forams. That's not my data. I looked at the data from Takeda and Kaiho, and the barium accumulation rate goes up. However, the data for ETM2 and ETM3 do not really show much of anything. We still have a slightly lower resolution here. We're selecting some more data. But for now, it seems that if we have this increased remineralization, then this may have happened during the PETM in the Pacific as well as in the Southeast Atlantic, but for the minor episodes, I don't see it. What are the implications? I see that I'm towards the end of my time. I'm also coming towards the end of my talk. The implications here would be that during hyperthermal events, at least in some parts of the ocean, more organic carbon was exported into the deep sea and remineralized, but it never reached the seafloor. This caused an increase in the reservoir of dissolved organic matter. There could be some potential feedbacks, and Don Penman, who was still at Yale at the time, he's now in Utah, was working on playing some games with LOSCAR modeling, and that is the carbon cycle model, as you see here at the bottom, by Dick Seebe. And we came with some preliminary observations there, and the model was telling us that our increased remineralization in this twilight zone in the oceans, of course, also drives increased productivity because we bring much more nutrients back into the oceans. However, this then also in the model did not result in the high organic flux to the seafloor because we set the remineralization at a high value. We also, however, saw something else, and that's kind of interesting, that is enhanced export productivity. If we keep the ratio of organic matter to calcium carbonate in this organic matter exported from the surface the same, that's called the rain ratio, then this enhanced export productivity removes not only organic matter, but also calcium carbonate from the surface waters. And that means that we're removing alkalinity from the surface waters, which lowers the pH and increases the higher the PCO2 in the surface waters, the dissolved CO2 in the surface waters, which means that we evade CO2 into the atmosphere. And so this would be a positive feedback effect during those hyperthermal events. Implications for the use of proxies. Well, marine pelagic barite accumulation and benthic foram accumulation have both been used as proxies for primary productivity because they depend upon the rain of primary produced organic matter. But our data show a negative correlation between those two. And so that means that it's impossible that both of them are proxies for primary productivity. And of course, it makes sense because they do not reflect the same part of the carbon cycle. So our data indicate that changes in the efficiency of water column processes in transferring organic matter to the seafloor during global warming may overshadow productivity changes considerably. And so that we're looking at the importance of changes in the global carbon cycle in the oceans as being more important on what happens with CO2 in the oceans than primary productivity itself. There's much more to do in this. And I myself want to do more about learning about the biological pump and the interaction of data and modeling, particularly how we parameterize this transport of organic matter from the surface waters to the deep sea across ecological changes. Benthic forams depend on the flux of organic matter, but so also they depend on the proportion of refractory matter. And that is of course linked again on how much remineralization will happen. They depend on seasonality and temperature which determines their metabolic rates and thus how much food they require. And they depend upon oxygenation levels. And the carbonate ones also depend upon calcium carbonate saturation. And so I think there's much more to be done if we indeed make sure that we collect our proxies in the same samples and that we compare proxies based on benthic 4 amps with those on surface calcifiers, whether planktic 4 amps or calcareous nanoplankton, and various geochemical proxies, so that we can combine information on the biological pump of the past and that we get information on both the export, the transfer to deeper water, the effect of remineralization of oxygen minimum zones, and the feedbacks to climate. So to wrap this up, our understanding of the potential effects of future global warming and associated changes in primary productivity in the biological pump may be improved by the study of the geological record of episodes of rapid global warming. And I kind of like to argue that because that kind of, I can't justify my existence, right? I can say, well, my work actually has some relevance. It's not just that I'm interested in climates of the past, which I am. It also may have some relevance for what we're seeing in the future. Although also I'm arguing that we must be very careful how we interpret our proxies. And so specifically, we have to make sure that indeed we need to use multiple proxies in order to reconstruct what was going on in the oceans in the past. So thank you for your attention. And on the left, I'm showing the various people who have been working with me over the years. There's data of lots of years of research in here. And I'm showing the people who have funded me over time, the National Science Foundation, as well as all the samples that I've been getting from the International Ocean Drilling Program. Thank you so much.